My talk is about the experience of Yugoslav tilt management and the radical plebeian democracy. So I have a little approach, and then I will talk about a bit of history of SFRY, self-management, and what I mean by radical plebeian democracy. Both democracy and communism, the two great attempts at collective power, have led to violent catastrophes. I believe this is because democracy and communism were divided instead of fused. I have approached this thoroughly radical democracy or democratic communism in essays about utopianism and political epistemology collected in my last three books, which I probably hope you got in the handout, so you can look it up. Socialist or communist revolutions against capital have, in their first historical round, 1917 to 89, failed to reach their own horizons, which also means they have pragmatically failed. There were heaven-storming hopes, even great and memorable successes, but the revolutions finally did not overcome the formidable obstacles which we can in one word call capital, outside and inside the countries of revolution. How can we begin summarizing the lessons of that failure? In three ways, I believe. Reconsidering the economics of the so-called transition period, this means quote unquote. Between the revolution and its goal of a fully just communist society. Second, reconsidering the economics by rethinking the cruces of accumulation and planning. Second, reconsidering our epistemology, which also means methodology, that is, how to understand a fast-changing history. And third, reconsidering the indispensable nexus between communism and democracy. I focus here on this third reconsideration, though it meshes strongly with the other two. I consider integral self-government from below, or radical plebeian democracy in all human affairs, synonymous with communism, our only hope to oppose the savage neo-fascist term of capitalism in which we are living. Further, I believe there is no critical stance to societal history without the foil of utopia as eutopia, the good place, in constant feedback with reality. I use as a shorthand for people whose interests and practice are opposed to the exploiters and power holders the term plebeian, as Brecht did, also Babeuf and Bakhtin. I mean by this a group of social classes working for their subsistence and not having had political power, the working people, radni narod. The plebeians are the only societal segment whose interests demand a thoroughgoing and radical democracy. I ground myself in Marx's anthropology of labor, as well as alienation in societal life. He did not work out a theory of political disalienation of labor beyond some precious theses about revolution and proletarian power. Still, the horizon of his doctrine was the organization of use-value politics within people's self-government. Marx saw no future for politics, since he held it was of a piece with exploitative class society. True, he assumed that associational democracy would be consubstantial with an emancipated labor process. But how would such a democracy from below reach its decisions? To begin with, if productive forces ought to be looked at with Marcuse and against economism as the term designating the sum total of the resources for liberation available to a given society, then relations of production, that is, politics with or without class struggles, have precedence over productive forces. Separating production and politics is counterproductive. This is true even for capitalism, but it holds in spades for socialist societies whose defining feature is the fusion of the apparatuses of the workplace with those of the state. Within such a fusion, self-management poses central questions for a radical democracy. First of all, can the relation between economic enterprises and the state be rethought around this alienating self-government? For self-government or self-determination is broader than the somewhat bureaucratic term of self-management, which does not clearly connote the radical liberatory aims of collective emancipation. My thesis is that self-management in the workplace centrally needs an integral plebeian civic democracy, intertwining with it as a double helix, and encompassing both the traditional negative and positive freedoms. The negative freedoms, freedoms from, at best protect individuals. The positive ones, freedoms for, constitute popular sovereignty. This fusion, constituting a radical plebeian democracy, is the institutional form of what I mean here by communism. I propose to discuss some historical horizons in SFRY, then the central politico-economical knot of self-management after the revolution, and finally, the politics of a possible disalienating communist democracy. So, part two, some history. Tensions and choices after the Yugoslav Revolution. In a Leninist post-revolutionary system, all means of production, except in the case of Yugoslavia, most agriculture, are taken over by the party state. Power was here wielded, unless counteracted by strong democratic pressures from below, by a relatively small oligarchy, a politocracy. It drew its legitimacy first from the revolutionary achievements of a plebeian upward mobility, which changed the life of millions for the better, and the attendant defense of independence, but then increasingly from the population's standard of living. The system, therefore, unless it were to rely largely on police repression, had to achieve a noticeable and ongoing economic surplus, and had to distribute it in a way that appeared justified to the majority of the population, especially the industrial working class and other city dwellers. Therefore, disposal of the surplus value arising from labor power, which had to be balanced between industrialization, defense, and standard, became a crux. In Yugoslavia, as in the USSR, the source of rapid capital accumulation was left unresolved. At the start, the Yugoslav communists hoped in fraternal aid by the socialist countries of the Soviet bloc. Instead, they got exploitation and attempts at takeover. Ironically, Tito then found in the Yugoslav army and its unique strategic value a source of both military and civilian US and West European aid. This was considerable. And together with the surrender of their surplus labor by most Yugoslav city dwellers, at first enthusiastic and then customary, tended to solve for a good while, say for 20 years, the pressing problem of accumulation source. However, it is today central to grasp that in order to continue at all, capitalism needs an ongoing, permanent, primitive accumulation, devastating further regions of nature and social life, women, virtual space, genome, intellect, etc. Thus, capital accumulation in Yugoslavia was unable to proceed for two reasons. Negatively, because of cultural, including technological backwardness, but then positively, because it meant the all-around disempowerment and alienation of people. However, the Yugoslav Revolution had originally been expressly designed, like all such great plebeian uprisings from the French through the Russian to the Chinese revolutions, to strongly limit these blights, as Professor Mochnik noted, by means of elements of solidarity, social responsibility, and control over the market mechanism worked into its institutional frame, unquote. And even to begin abolishing them. While SFR Yugoslavia eventually embarked upon the road of capitalization, it did so much too slowly and imperfectly by capitalist standards. in order to bring about a full capitalism without the human face that we are seeing in these last decades, it had to be destroyed. In particular, I have argued that the Yugoslav experience is best divided into three phases. About 1952 to 65, the ascent. 1965 to 72, a failed reform and transition to degeneration. And 1972 to the end, stasis and repression. Internationally, before about 73, the Cold War political competition allowed economic growth outside the capitalist metropolitan areas, violating exclusive profit logic. This was followed by a period of erosion, crisis, and breakdown of this anti-fascist phase, and eventually the return to pure profit capitalism, to all of which Yugoslavia became a prime example. After this date, that is end of 60s, before beginning of 70s, SFR Yugoslavia as a community still did some good things for hundreds of thousands of people, but it was a devolving caricature of the original project. Was there an alternative to the degeneration and eventual crash? My hypothesis is that there was. In a further development of the tradition of the partisan popular revolution, expressed in the great slogans Smrt fašizmu, sloboda narodu and Bratstvo jedinstvo. That is an orientation towards a plebeian alliance from below. This had made the party shy away from Stalinist parasitary and stagnant monopolism with its unbearable cost in terror and people's blood. The Yugoslav rulers and theoreticians attempted after 1949, with notable but less than full success, to get rid of the execrated Stalinism, deeply rooted both in the old party cadre and the widespread peasant come patriarchal petty bourgeois mentality. And to go back to the radical Lenin of state and revolution, whose libertarianism also struck a deep chord in the traditions of popular self-government and of partisan self-reliance. The 1945 to 52 years I have called the double Yugoslav plebeian singularity of partisan victory with political centralization and speedy economic reconstruction of the country, and then of successful break with Stalinism. This resulted in a major breakthrough of the workers' self-management idea. In 1953, the Yugoslav economy took off after years of scarcity, and at least one factor of the boom was the enthusiasm created by the workers' councils. Due to the pressure from below, the self-management organs in industries gradually gained greater influence over some key decisions, including those about workers' income. Further, the area of operation of self-management was in 53 extended from industry to state agriculture, trade, construction, transport and communications, and then also to education, culture, health services, banking and insurance. It was not applied to the army and security services, public administration and the court system. Soon self-management was timidly introduced to the parliamentary or electoral systems at the levels of commune, district, republic, and federation. The 1957 to 65 year plan had a resounding success. Some results of those years can be seen in tables from official statistics. Look at the table one in your handout. There was a high rate of growth, industrial expansion, an increase in the standards of living, and the shift of employment from the primary into the secondary and tertiary spheres of the economy. Labor productivity rose an average of about 4% per year, a surprising achievement when employment was also rising. Yet, Yugoslavia remained a relatively underdeveloped and extremely unevenly developed economy, with an inadequate infrastructure, with a per capita social product about half that of Italy. Furthermore, while improving, productivity was still low. and trouble was brewing because of some central structural contradictions. A strong harbinger of possible changes was, despite its many compromises, the party program promulgated in 1958, which was also notable for the all-time high of 32% worker members in the party. The program had a strongly resonating concluding quote. Nothing that has been created must be so sacred for us that it cannot be surpassed and leave its place to what is still more progressive, more free, more human, unquote. The reflux of the plebeian tide. In the 1950s, two momentous changes had become deeply embedded. First, however intimately the economy, the state, and the party might remain interconnected and controlled by the last, these three subsystems have been given separate formal structures with capacities for autonomous growth. Second, the process of decentralizing party control from the top, but not transferring power to the lowest levels, created a middle layer of state and party officials who were very anxious to preserve their positions and therefore became pillars of dogmatism and the establishment. These local rulers came to exercise great discretion in economic matters and use their powers to pursue the interests of their own region, which amounted to obtaining investments for the construction of industry and then protecting that industry at any cost. For example, 5 oil refineries in Little Yugoslavia. The commune oligarchy level, for which power was synonymous with opening jobs and extensive economic development, was well integrated with the republican level, I mean Slovenia, Serbia, Croatia, etc. Since it was paid out of taxes on production, as time went on, this level became one of the main drags of self-management and democratization, eventually second only to the republican administrations. These oligarchies below the federal level grew into the root cause for an increasingly evasive ideological and political consensus within the ruling oligarchy. The dilemma was always whether to carry out further the democratization from below, which would inevitably begin spilling over from economics to politics, or to return to central rule from above. The compromise solution was to do neither, but to give more power to the republican administration, that is, the creation of a federation which cannot rule over the oligarchic elements in the republics. The republican governments tended from the very beginning to centralize all in their hands and were left to grow by default into separate state capitalisms, if you wish. The economy stalled and eventually plummeted. Do not speak about the post-1972 developments. In such a bind, the Western type of market appeared around 65 to most people in the oligarchy and, of course, in the rising middle class as the new savior. Industries which could compete in the market had to be favored. Besides economic objectives of this reform, its key political plank was that the share of enterprises in the net social product should rise from 30 to 70%. This failed. Instead, its three main consequences were, first, conspicuous economic instability. Most worrisome for societal solidarity were rising unemployment at the time when the better schooled post-war generation was looking for work, and inflation caused by high import costs and by domestic factors such as low productivity in industry and agriculture, which henceforth became a fixture and led to marked inefficiency of Yugoslav investments as compared to other countries of European periphery. The inflation came to average 22% by the early 1970s and began affecting the real wage. Of course, you know all the 1980s, it was horrible. Second, the balance, so first economic instability. Second, the balance between the federal center and the republics was drastically altered in favor of the latter. The transfer of responsibility for social services from the federal center to the commune and then to the republics entailed a transfer of loyalties. This was one more factor of the third consequence, the increasing societal polarization, reversing the post-war trend. Income growth rates of the upper 10% grew in the late 60s to more than double of the bottom 40%. To say, they grew twice as quickly. On the one pole, there was an exodus of workers to Western Europe with a peak of at around 1 million people by 1973. On the other, a lightning concentration of capital in the reformed banks, which could now be founded not only by local communities, but primarily by business enterprises. The banks soon accounted for half of all fixed asset investments, and in agreement with Republican authorities, disposed of foreign currency earnings. The government could only resort to ad hoc zigzagging by means of administrative monetary policy, a few remaining federal subsidies and investments, as well as temporary extraordinary fiscal measures. While this meant that its surviving redistributive role helped to keep differences in the standard of living from growing intolerable up to the 1980s, it also meant that federal intervention was done without long-range planning, and not surprisingly, created more problems than it solved. Finally, industrial production fell in the 1970s to the fourth source of currency revenues by value, after remittances from workers abroad, tourism, and agriculture. This was a resounding defeat of the political plank of industrialization. The federal state was economically withering away, and so was rapid progress in production and standard of living. The economic consequences came to a head much later, but the political instability and polarization were immediate. The student revolt in 68, and the Croatian slide towards nationalism interrupted in 71. They were ominous, especially as their causes were not addressed. Just as ominous was the turn to the International Monetary Fund loans given in 65 to Yugoslavia as the first socialist country. Part 3. Some reflections on Yugoslav self-management. I cannot give you the data and the reflections contained in 150 pages of my book. It is downloadable from Rosa Luxemburg, Beograd, Samo jedna se ljubi, so I hope you can check it for yourself. And there is an English book which is not downloadable. I shall here touch only on two matters about the system of workers' councils. First, a brief introduction about how they function. Second, on what transpires from the tables you'll find in your handout, numbers 5 to 9 and then number 16. First, self-management, beginning with workers' councils and industry, was excogitated by a few people in the 1949 Communist Party Politburo, mainly Kidrich, as a way out of two major problems that could not be solved by centralized state command. First, the need for renewed popular consent and participation in a seriously threatened country. Second, the need for rising productivity while preserving social justice. It unleashed major energies and expectations from the working class and the whole working people for a redistribution of power downward. When in the 50s independence was preserved and the economy took off, pressure from below gained for the workers' councils a veto on the appointment of enterprise manager and decision power on workers' income after subtraction of state taxes. Would you stop, please? Yes. And decision power on workers' income after subtraction of state taxes. Also, self-management was extended to state agriculture, trade, construction, transport, and communications, and later to education, culture, and health services. The battle turned in the 60s to how is the net income to be divided between the enterprise and its worker council versus the state. The radical 1949-52 project by Kidrich had envisaged council democracy from top to bottom, which would soon combine flexible central planning with input from below. Yet this was abandoned, so that how to decide democratically about investment priorities, prices, subventions, and foreign trade was left to the oligarchy. The workers' councils were not a full workers' control, since the appointment of managers was strongly conditioned by the municipality, and two-thirds of the net income were taken by the state without any worker's say. Yet in its heyday of 1958-68, they made workers' councils for a significant worker participation, more in shop floor and income matters, less in investment decisions. The self-managing collective was composed of manual workers, technicians, professionals, and clerical staff with equal rights of decision. No one could be expelled except for a clear reason and following detailed procedures. The collective had no property rights in the net worth. The result of its activity were sold to the market. All employees of an enterprise were deemed producers, including those under 18 and trainees, and elected biennially a non-remunerated workers' council of between 15 to 120 members as the supreme management body. The council met monthly, and any member of the enterprise could be present to listen. In the 60s, the spread between minimum and maximum income, not counting perks for the top, was between 1 to 4 and 1 to 7, and the rising. My impression is that up to 1972, the workers' incomes were decent for those who had an apartment, but many didn't, in the city, I mean. Whereas for the skilled workers and the upper half of the staff, they were very good, and for the top staff, at times opulent. The Workers' Council elected a managing board of 3 to 11 members, executive organ for current decisions, which in the 1970s began to be packed by specialists and to overshadow the parent body. Even before, though power was up to a point shared by the director and his technical staff with the highly skilled and skilled workers, yet women and lower ranks only counted in case of general dissatisfaction, say a strike or something like that. At its height, self-management yielded amazing results, absorbing the shocks of urbanization and of decision decentralization by creating collective commitment and comradely care. Look at the discussions from the Torquist book in your handout. So there's an exemplary discussion about firing something. Special praise is due to the vertically organized, truly self-managed, independent interest communities for health, education, science, and culture, which introduced the first wedge of democracy into traditionally patriarchal relations, but were neutralized in the 70s. Did self-management economically perform well? In microeconomics, odds are that yes. In macroeconomics, only if and when certain macro knots, KN, okay, were smoothed out. And after 1965, they were not. However, enlarging self-management horizontally outside of industry and vertically up to the real state of power, the party state center, into a full plebeian associative democracy was the precondition for enabling its initial forms that I have described to function properly. To the contrary, in the 1970s, despite obfuscating verbiage, the Cardellian stuff, you know, there was perpetuated the ghetto of workers' council kept only at the level of single enterprises, which reduced them to a caricature. The economic effects were disastrous. See table 12. Now, what can be read out of the tables 5, A, B, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 16 with a curious mind behind the eye? First, the workers' councils were the first and probably only really functioning mass disseminating movement in Yugoslav history after the partisan movement, especially in 58 to 68, the golden age of Yugoslav self-management. Look at table 6. To have over 150,000 working people, of which 3/4 from the shop floor, manual workers, okay, meet once a month after the 48, later 40 hours work week, and decide without payment, in a number of cases, perhaps out of career ambition, but on the whole mostly as a civic duty, or if you wish, duty to their comrades, decide how to improve the working conditions in their factory or similar enterprise, how to produce more or better, or even only how to earn more or how to divide it better, and to do it maybe 24 times in the 2 years of their mandate seems to me quite a staggering exercise. No collective grouping before had spanned the whole of Yugoslavia, comprising women and men, manual and mental workers, as the 10,000 workers' councils in direct production, not counting just as interesting 8,500 councils with further 200,000 members in health, culture, and so on. Since workers' council elections were annual until 59 and biennial after that, we do not know how many different people passed through it. We know how many members there were, but how many same people were in it, we don't know. But no elected member could serve more than twice in succession, and it seems that about 30 to 50% were re-elected for a second mandate, all of which was an option for education in breadth, right? Get people who don't know anything, and while they are members, they learn. Thus, I calculate that in 50 to 58, out of 1.7 million industrial workers, possibly 1 in 4 participated in management bodies. Perhaps more if one counts the self-managing bodies for all the 3 million in full employment, that's to say outside of industry too. And there were sub-commissions and God knows what. Obviously, there were much bigger paper groups in SFRY, such as the League of Communists or the Socialist League of Working People, but they were for most of the time and most of the important decisions guided from above. Thus, perhaps as a whole important and for some members useful, but very little disalienating. Second, the Workers' Council in production understood at the latest after the first meeting that the government is taxing away 2/3 of their production. No doubt, in part for indispensable matters such as defense, but still leaving the producers finally in a position that the most lucid inside commentator after Kidrich, Vladimir Bakarich, once cynically called the same position as the direct producers in the Maya statelets of the pre-capitalist Middle Ages of the Yucatan Peninsula. Okay? The state takes 2/3. Kidrich quite early on and Kardel and Bakarich in the middle 60s even theorized that the proportion should be in a properly revolutionary way turned on its head. That is to say, the direct producers should dispose of 2/3 and the state, local, republican, and federal governments only 1/3 of the working surplus. However, this was tried for maybe 1.5 years, sabotaged by the oligarchy at all those state levels, hastily and totally abandoned and never again discussed in the corridors of power. The 1974 reforms were paper tigers, as the Chinese nicely say. Third, I wish you to pay special attention to table 5B in your handout on the workers' schooling, which received generous financing from the trade unions and from enterprises during the first 15 years. I have found very little data about the subject matters taught. For example, how many were general matters. I think it was rather focused on acquisition on skills, which went hand in hand with higher salary. Nonetheless, training workers who had come to industrial work after the war from the countryside was acute in a country where before 45 there were few industrial, managerial, or scientific skills, and 2/3 of the youngsters still had 4 years schooling or less. Workers' universities, so-called, did not lack buildings and equipment, but they were very short of trained teaching personnel and relied much more on mass lectures than on tutorials or student participation. Still, education could be contracted for on the basis of an enterprise's or a group of enterprises' needs. Workers could thus complete their primary education, vocational schooling, obtain higher qualifications, learn a foreign language, and prepare for entrance examinations to universities. Table 5B shows the culmination of so-called workers' universities in 67-68. 236 of them held 4,000 courses with 311,000 participants and over 20,000 lectures with 2 million listeners. This number fell abruptly after 1970, though enterprises continued to generously fund selected members for study at regular universities, mainly technological ones, but also economics and such stuff. On top of general education at all levels, beginning with the 8-year obligatory basic schooling after 45, and the huge expansion of the university system, it was the worker-managed enterprises which developed their own upgrading programs in many areas of applied technology, such as telecommunication, civil engineering, building, shipbuilding, agriculture. The result achieved ex nihilo by the former worker trainees were found by foreign experts to be quite astounding. Finally, look at Branko Horvat, the great SFRY economist, fired three or four times by the government. Stunning table 16. A very condensed but precise historical economic verdict on material growth in four epochs of Yugoslav history. Capitalism before the Great Depression up to 32, during the Depression 32-40, etatism, the Stalinist centralized model 46-54, and the optimistically named self-government epoch 56-67. Turned out not to be a self-government epoch, but okay. Capitalism, first, does not manage to have employment keeping pace even with the demographic increment of population. In the first phase, it adds a little bit each year to the rather dubious category of gross natural product, to my mind, at least of one third of this category is of no real use to people. It's just paper profits. But even this would look very sad if comparison to Czechoslovakia or Italy were used. However, even such paper advantage turns de facto into negative growth during the Depression, which we know, of course, in the last few years else. Etatism, the Stalinist scheme, manages much better by a huge leap in investments combined with employment, but the traitorous category of efficiency reveals this productivity is based on extensive force feeding, unavoidable in the beginning in industrialization, but impossible to sustain all along because much too profligate, thus leading to bankruptcy. Only self-management, though kept to about half of what the most sincere theoreticians of the oligarchy thought was needed, that is 33% instead of 67%, managed not only to have a real takeoff of the living standard, together with a rise of employment almost matching the beginnings of industrialization, a rate of investment into fixed assets, which is only three quarters of the frenzied pace of the post-war years, but more than double that of capitalism at its best on this terrain, not capitalism in America or Germany, okay, here. And most important, together with the rise of efficiency, that is technical progress and productivity, 50% better than capitalism at its best. This is the self-management 56 to 67. I much wonder what comparisons with the deindustrialization from 1989 in our countries would show today. Probably a cross between the pre-1932 and post-1932 robber capitalism. concluding. I have two parts. The problem. The oligarchy's counteroffensive against the trend towards plebeian association of democracy based on self-management develops after 68 into political disorientation, fruitlessly papered over by a feverish proliferation of measures and laws, and brings about elements of vigorously developing capitalist relationships. No economic democracy can survive unless accompanied by political democracy, is my conclusion. To my mind, there existed at that moment three possible theoretically exclusive horizons. The year 1948 was marked by the rejection of the first horizon, a Soviet-style police state with totally centralized detailed planning, as intrinsically abhorrent and achievable only by full submission to Stalin, number one. The second horizon was rendered more urgent by what was, in my judgment, a necessary opening to the capitalist world market, and therefore to confrontation with its evolving ideologies. However, this confrontation didn't happen. Instead, the dubiously named market socialism came about as the minimum common denominator of an intra-oligarchy compromise by default, not as an act of positive policy. The market was mystified as a socialist invisible hand, vehemently opposed to federal planning, to what could have been a planned economy using a regulated market mechanism. Not corrected by and subordinated to such strong planning, the market tended towards a reintroduction of capitalism. I cannot discuss here the many improvisations tending towards a kind of cooperative plus state capitalism. In the Yugoslav case, a confederation of major republican state capitalism, but they were strengthening the probability of what historically happened. A potential division into comprador bourgeoisies and mafias actualized as soon as the Cold War confrontation was definitely over. However, this alternative could be used as the only way to avoid the police state only insofar as it was willfully occulted that there existed an already partially mobilized, popular, and quite well-functioning germ of a third, properly plebeian socialist horizon, a fully associational plebeian democracy, consciously assuming the conflict between the old capitalism and patriarchal power and the new democratic communism as its orientation. This would have meant both accepting the consumer market as a reckoning device, that is in a rather prudent way, and denying the capitalist law of value in key sectors affecting the people's well-being in favor of a supple planning. As of 58, when the party program called for the transformation of all state organs into organs of self-government, this vision was a widespread horizon, a Blochian possible utopia. It is then that in the Republican and Federal Assemblies, besides two chambers composed of professional politicians, three chambers were added: for economic policies, for social services and health, and for education and culture, composed from delegates of basic organizations in the field and having no financial privileges, only costs paid in Belgrade. There were expectations and pressures at the time to expand self-management across the board, to territorial communities, vertically to several permanent central councils, a kind of working people's parliament, relying on scientific analysis and planning. This democratization would have had to prominently include the ruling party transforming into an organization with decentralized initiatives in which members had the possibility of controlling the leadership, so that in the decision process, communications and directives would circulate both up and down. However, the political backers of self-management, a minor part of the ruling oligarchy, most of the humanist intelligentsia, and the majority of the atomized and silent industrial workers lacked an embattled pressure from the plebeian depths, which would have been allowed to organize within the bounds of the socialist constitution against the major part of the oligarchy. The refusal to collocate self-management in production within a full self-government, that is, plebeian democracy, resulted finally in the downfall of both self-management and Yugoslavia. This was signaled early on by the rise of the two evil capitalist poles, financial capital and unemployment. See table 13 and 14b. Finally, politics after the revolution and today. My conclusion is twofold according to my two main interests: to learn from yesterday, to think about today and tomorrow. First, about yesterday. There is no reason to suppose that when the alienating politics of class domination coupled with a repressive state are abolished by a revolution, this would or could mean the end of politics. Though Marx often thought this would be the case, Gramsci did well to return to politics, that is, decisions how to allocate labor, as a central, long-duration human need. With the exception of Gramsci and some cognate writings absent from official Marxism, say by Luxembourg and Brecht, Marxist thought lacked a reflection on power and the techniques of its installation and practicing from the point of view of those who undergo it. Not on how to get to power, how to do when you have it. We have learned above board politics is needed to prevent a resurgent state apparatus, prominent including the police and the military, from becoming as strongly alienating as capitalism and finally succumbing to it. Despite some early successes, the Communist Party of Yugoslavia mutated into a ruling class that increasingly failed to understand the necessity of persuasion in hegemony, and as of the late 60s therefore lost its vanguard role and credibility among key social classes such as the manual workers and the left intellectuals, as it had lost in 1949 for peasants. My different sense of the party has to do with Marx's final conception of it as a kind of collector and articulator of all societal energies, proposals and interests of the plebeians, which would include Gramsci's wider sense of intellectuals. Intellectuals, anybody who learns something. Only such a new understanding and mass practice could make of a revolution not simply the expropriation of the expropriators, but also a process by which a people changes and makes itself under the leadership of the new hegemonic class and its movement. For how can we expect to transform human life to create a social society as distinct from a socially owned and managed economy when the mass of people are excluded from the political process and may even be allowed to drift into depoliticization and apathy about public matters? A Gramscian concept of civil society, a model with full respect both for a right to individual self-determination against any collective and for the right of an open society to survive and cherish supra-individual values with the key parameter of creating labor, seems to me utterly indispensable for two reasons. One is to establish what was missing beside radical self-management in the economy in really existing and eventually suicidal socialism. The second is what is missing beside radical self-management in the economy in really existing and currently suicidal capitalism. Since power is quite indispensable for major choices, I don't mean violence, just power, it must be tamed from below by checks and balances through open debate, that is politics. Such a civil society would need and create its own lobbies and think tanks where intelligence and devotion can take the place of wealth. They can only function well when backed by vigorous associations access to mass media, a somewhat self-limiting state bound by a division of power, a Rechtsstaat, rather than a discretionary apparatus and eventually wider social movement. Finally, second, about today. The need for politics is diametrically opposed to the capitalist hegemony of the oligarchic archosphere over the human interests for life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Driven by profit considerations that override the obviously ensuing collateral of future horrors. The need for a strongly oppositional civil society is rendered crystal clear by unbridled financial capitalism that ushers in ecological and societal collapse. The ideal horizon of the interaction of civil society with the state and capitalist powers is to strongly influence and largely tame them both. However, should this plebeian impulse fail, what would remain is the alternative between radical revolution or despotic barbarism. In sum, Marx's act of intellectual insurrection led to an often dreamed of, but before him not that clearly established horizon, communism as the never-ending self-critical return of the democratic return, and vice versa. This sketches in a two-way street. If communism can only be radical plebeian democracy, only communism can be radical plebeian democracy. Thank you.
Hvala lepa za predavanje. Predlagam, da odpremo razpravo za par vprašanj. Kako se slažete? Lahko jih zastavite v slovenščini, hrvaščini, angleščini. Še preden pa to storimo, vas pa obveščam, da lahko dva članka, ki sta bila prevedena in objavljena v slovenščino, v reviji Borec, kupite tamle v prihodu. Zdaj pa odpiram razpravo.
Lahko
slovenščini?
Lahko, da. Okay. Me zanima, kako vi razumete, prav na začetku je bil režim, predvsem, koliko ste sami rekli, staliničničen, se pravi nek partijski vrh, ki je vladal skozi centralizirano hierarhijo. Kako razumete to odločitev, da je sploh prišlo do uvedbe pač delavskih svetov? Kaj, tako, na nek prvi interes pač te že usedlane, že ukopane oblasti te partijskega vrha je, jaz mislim, kaj je bil njihov interes, da so se šli zapletati, rečemo temu, ne, situaciju.
Čujte, to je bilo 49. Ruski tenkovski korpusi su na našim granicama, od Mađarske do Grčke. Stalin je živ. Obnova je gotova, industrializacija je počela, ali ljudi su umorni. Partijski vrh je došao iz partizana, partijski vrh nije 15 ljudi, partijski vrh je 10, 20, 30, 50 hiljada ljudi. Partizani su se snašli, snađi se druže, radi sam. Jel? Nije bilo, osim grupe oko Tita, koja je bila mala na početku, ne, to su bili odredi svugde, od Bele Krajine do Makedonije. Komande su išle od glavnog štaba kuririma 5 dana dok su stigle nekuda. Tako da je i partizani, i partizanski odredi, i narodni odbori, AFŽ, omladina, to je sve bilo od ozdola na gore. To je bilo spontano, to je bio instrument za preživljavanje naroda. To nije metafora, to je doslovno. Jel? jer su taj narod ubijali fašisti, ljotićevci, Mađari, Bugari, pite Boga ko sve ne, ne, ustaše, četnici, beli i tak dalje. Svi ti ljudi su došli s partizana, njima reći idemo uvesti u... To nije bila još vladajuća klasa 49. To je bila klasa in statu na šendi. Protoklas, to zove Lenin. Radovima o agrikulturi Rusije. Moguća klasa. Mislim da je to postala klasa oko 65. Prava vladajuća klasa. Ja ju zovem oligarhija ukratko, ali ona se razvijala u vremenu. 49. to je bila narodna vlada, stvarno došla iz naroda, su bili seljaci, eventualno su neki bili na univerzitetu, ali vrlo malo od njih, ne? Ti trebaš pomoć, ti trebaš narodni entuzijazam da se proizvodi dalje, ti trebaš narodni entuzijazam ako uđu ruski tenkovi da idemo opet u partizane. Brda, ne? Ostavimo im Zagreb i Beograd, idemo u Brda, to je bio plan. I onda smo imali sreću da smo imali jednog velikog genija, se zvao Boris Kidrić. On je čitao Parisku komunu i rekao, a zašto da mi ne uzmemo to što su oni imali? Pa o tom govori Lenin, pa o tom govori Marks. To je samo upravu. Ja? Prvi interes svake klase, vladajuće, nevladajuće, da preživi. To je bio način da se preživi. Drugi interes je da se vlada što bolje i što više. Ne? Prvo mora živjeti da bi mogao vladati. Tako da je to bila jedna konstelacija, jedinstvena, mislim, partizanske tradicije, jel? Potreba obnoviti veze sa masom, koja je opasno bila, sjetite se, to je vreme te nesretne ideje, ne znam čije, Kardeljeve, o forsiranim kolektivnim seljačkim radnim zadrugama. Ne? Otjerali seljake batinom u radne zadruge. A šta su bili seljaci? Seljaci su svi bili partizani, očevi partizana, sinovi partizana, brati partizana. I sad ti njih tjeraš, onaj brat koji je otišao na vlast, tjera brata koji je ostao na selu. Pa to je propalo za godinu i pol, ne? I sad kako ćeš obnoviti tu neku vezu? Ja? I onda smo imali sreću da smo, mislim, Đilas je tvrdio, to on izmislio, ali to ne vjerujem. Đilas je možda dodao, Đilas i Kardelj su diskutirali sa Kidrićem, Đilas i Kardelj pojma nisu imali u ekonomiji. Kardelj je posle mislio da ima pojma pa je napravio ono što je napravio, ne, užase Bože. Ali on je čovjek koji stvarno razumije ekonomiju, radio 46. dan na dan, ako vidite u arhiv CK, vidite zapisnike sastanka Kidrića sa svim ekonomskim faktorima u svakoj branši, kako... To je bio Kidrić. Tako da mi se to čini sasvim normalna mogućnost koja je poslije onda negirana. To je ono što ja kažem, da je alternativa postojala. To nije Hirngespinst, što kažem Njemci, to nije moja izmišljotina. To je bilo tu, ali onda kad je nastala stvarna vladajuća klasa i oligarhija, ne, onda se puca policijom na ljude. I onda ti ne možeš meni reći da ja moram imati pravi self-government gdje ljudi imaju razna mišljenja i mogu reći pa ti si sad bio 15 godina na vlasti, a šta si napravio ne, baš ne znamo, ajde se malo ti makni u penziju. To ćeš reći 20-30 hiljada političara ćeš tako maknuti, pa neće se dati, nisu se dali. 40, 50, 60, ne koliko je bila ta jezgra oligarhije, plus familije, plus vile na Dedinju, plus automobili, plus etc. Kad mislim, kad nije bilo drugih automobila, nego samo država. Dakle, tu su bili veliki interesi psihički i fizički, materijalni. Ti interesi 49. nisu još bili tako važni. Bio je interes da mi vidimo da li će Stalin doći ili ne, hoće li narod biti s nama ili ne. Ko što je bio 41. 42. 43. 44. To mi se ne čini ništa abnormalnog, to mi se čini jedna mogućnost briljantno iskorištena. A onda je bilo drugih isto tako interesantnih mogućnosti briljantno odbačenih. Da se tako izrazi.
Hvala. Mogu na hrvatskom. Da li je uopšte moguće spriječiti to da se ova oligarhija stvara u bilo kojem sistemu? Recimo, baš ono što ste sada napomenuli, kad oni, recimo, kad neko preuzima vlast ili kad neko dobije ovu snagu, bar može i u kolektivima i u politici i to, da li je uopšte to moguće da nekako, da se ne napravi ta klasa? Kod nas su im kazali aparatčik i onaj middle layer. Kako bi bile te mogućnosti? Jer ja mislim da u svakom, skoro svugde ima tu ta tenzija da neki koji su došli nekako na vlast da tamo ostaju. Čak i recimo kod nas u Sloveniji kad smo imali ovaj pokušaj kapitalizma, ljudskog kapitalizma, kao svi će dobiti neke certifikate i to, odmah su se našli neki koji su to pokupili. Znači, ja mislim da ta tenzija nije vezana na sistem, nego na, šta je znam, na to kako se ljudi, kako radimo. Imate neki, možda...
Vi govorite o ljudskoj prirodi, ja u ljudsku prirodu ne vjerujem. Ja vjerujem u ljudsku prirodu pod kapitalizmom, u ljudsku prirodu pod socijalizmom, u ljudsku prirodu pod primitivnim socijalizmom, u ljudsku prirodu pod bogatim socijalizmom. Svaćate, u ljudsku prirodu, tu kur, darvinističku, nekakvu socijal-darvinističku, ne čovjek i čovjeku vuk, to je normalno. Moc tua vita mea, ne? Život, moj život je tvoja smrt. To je kapitalizam. Ok. Je li ja vjerujem da je moguće suzbiti oligarhiju u kapitalizmu? Ne. Je li moguće socijalizmu? Teoretski da. Je li lahko? Ne. Jako teško. Kako bi to bilo teoretski moguće sa sistemom direktne demokracije od ozdo, ne parlamentarne, prosim. Parlament uništava demokraciju. Jel? Nakon 848. Jakobinci možda ne, Cromwell možda ne. Cromwell je uništio demokraciju, također. Ali recimo, prema tome vjerovati u parlament znači smrt. Koristiti parlament, to je drugi padež. Za organiziranje baze, propagandu, ideologije i tako dalje. To je drugi padež. To ima vrlo interesantnih diskusija kod Lenjina 905. do 914. Da se ide u parlament ili ne. Lenin je bio za to da se ide. Ne puristi Bogdanovi kompaniju su rekli ne, to su sve svinje, mi nećemo s njima imati posla. Da se ide, ali da se koristi za propagandu na terenu. Jer teren će nas spasiti, a parlament je tak protiv nas, šta god mi njima rekli. U socijalizmu, ako, mislim, postoje izborni sistemi, vrlo lijepo razrađeni, sa obligatornim mandatom. Jel? Buržoazija je izmislila slobodu izabranoga, koja je protiv slobode birača. To jest ja tebe izaberem, a posle si slobodan da radiš kaj god hoćeš. Dakle, lagal buš mi dok te ne izaberem, onda buš radil kaj god hoćeš. I ne možeš. Ako recimo 1/3 tvojih birača zahtjeva da odeš, izvoliš otići, mi ćemo drugoga. Jel? To jest mi smo te izabrali da povisiš plaće. Ti si potplaćen od kapitalista i glasaš protiv povišenja plaća jer to krši evropske norme i kaj ja znam kaj. Ja te upozovem. Gotovo. Dakle, teoretski je moguće, konkretno u konkretnim situacijama zavisi. Mi nismo imali radničku klasu. 45. bilo je, statistike su nejasne, statistike stare Jugoslavije su socijalnog osiguranja, koje su znači činovnici i radnici skupa, ne? Ali otprilike možda 400.000 u industriji. Od tog je polovina izginula, neki tvrde da radnici nisu sudjelovali u NOP. To su gluposti, Milandžić i kompanija. Bilo ih je 20 put manje od seljaka, ali proporcionalno su sudjelovali više od seljaka. I uglavnom skoro svi kvalificirani radnici, ala Josip Broz, su izginuli. Josip Broz nije, slučajno, ne? Slučajno se spasio jer je kroz jednu špilju pobjegao. Ne, znate ono, Bervaro. Prema tome, 45. 49 radnika od 50 bilo je seljaka sa sela ili 99 od 100, nisam izračunao. Sad su došli, direktori su došli iz partizana, jel? Seljaci su bili partizani, obični vojnici, a direktori su bili partizani oficiri. Svi su bili seljaci, a otkud bi u Đavoljom došli? Neki su bili intelektualci namještenici, vrlo malo njih. Ti su uglavnom svršili u republičkim i beogradskim centralnim vladama, ne? Dakle, ako me pitate je li ljudska priroda takva da uvijek mora biti vladara i vladanih, ne. Ako ima dovoljno bogatstva i ako ima dovoljno organizirane pritiska odozdo. U siromašnim zemljama sigurno uvijek mora biti vladara, jel? To je jedan put lijepo opisao Trocki, otkuda dolazi birokracija. Pa kaže, kad nema kruha, onda je rep. Pred prodavonu, onda mora policija da drži red u repu. Evo ti vlast. Jel? Ja, alak ima ne samo kruha, nego i putra i mesa i tako dalje, i osim toga drugih stvari potrebnih za hranu psihe, a ne samo od tijela i tako dalje. Je to odgovor?
Je to odgovor?
Je.
Še kakšno vprašanje mogoče, komentar, kritika?
Samo vprašanje. Moje vprašanje bom postavil po ugotovitvi, da je danes v razvitem svetu nepredstavljivo se zamisliti ekonomijo brez zadrug.
Brez?
Brez zadrug, brez, selja, brez, kako se reče, udruga.
Kooperativa.
Brez kooperativa, da.
Ja.
In kolikor, jaz sicer nisem sociolog, ampak kolikor mi je znano, je tudi pred drugo svetovno vojno v Sloveniji so imele zadruge pomembno vlogo v družbenem in ekonomskem življenju. To velja tudi za kmetijske zadruge. Vprašanje je pa tole, kaj se je zgodilo narobe? Kje je tista napaka, recimo sistemska napaka, zaradi katere ste vi danes ugotavljali, da je bila uvedba zadrug leta 45 oziroma takoj
pod... 1940.
No, pač.
Dobro, velika kampanja
je bila. Ja, velika kampanja. Da je že nekaj let po tej veliki kampanji večina teh zadrug, novoustanovljenih zadrug, predvsem pa kmetijskih zadrug, žalostno končala. In s tem tudi na nek način osramotila teoretika teh zadrug Kardelja. Kaj je šlo narobe?
Kardelj kao teoretik za mene je prilično bijedna figura. Dobronamjerna, radina, je stalno pisao, jadni čovjek. Pustimo to na miru, ja sam to pisao na 60 strana moje knjige, možete pa pustimo Kardelja na miru. Dok imamo agrikulturu ovakvu ko što je znamo od neolitika do danas, jel? Možda ćemo neku drugu hidroponsku i tako dalje, jel? Ali dok imamo onu za koju treba zemlja, i imamo ovu demografiju, ogromnu masu ljudi koju treba hraniti, treba velike posjede. 8, 10, 15 hektara ništa ne daju. Ne može se imati dovoljni prinos. Treba 100, 200, 1000, 5000 hektara. 10, 20, koliko ima u Americi prosječno, ja ne znam. Ima dve mogućnosti za velike posjede. Ili je vlada kapitalist, jedna korporacija, to se zove agribiznes. Svi drugi su namještenici, kad ih trebam ih uzmem, 3 mjeseca na godinu, 4, 5, 6, kad ih ne trebam ih bacim van, neka gladuju 6 mjeseci itd. Ima masu mašina, ima mehaničare koji to podmazuju, ne, te ne mogu baciti van jer moraju celu zimu podmazivati itd. Drugo je veleposjed upravljan od kolektiva, zadruga, radna zadruga. Pazite, ne prodajna zadruga, to je drugi padež, što je bilo u Sloveniji prije rata, nego radna zadruga. Pa sigurno da je to moguće, zašto ne? Zato treba visoki nivo tehnologije, traktori, gnojiva, cela, sve što treba, ne? Što 49. Jugoslaviji nije bilo ni 1%. To je bila ludost. Razumijete? Pa tek se gradila željezara, pa kako buš imali traktore? Ne? Treba visoki nivo političke svijesti. Treba visoki nivo kulture. Ti ne možeš uzeti tu mašinu i razbiti ju za dva dana jer ju nikad vidjeli nisi. Nisi bil u kursevima, niti znaš kak ju voziš. Mislim kulture, ne mislim citiranja Šekspira. Mislim kulture življenja. Ja? Citirat Šekspira nije loše, nota bene, puno naučiš od toga. Ali to sve mi nismo imali. Zašto smo mi išli u tu kolektivizaciju? Zato što je Kardelj bio 35. 36. na Kubanu i vidio kolektivizaciju. Kardelj je bio u Rusiji poslan od CK. I pošto je Stalin rekao, Kardelj je bio pod velikim uplivom Stalina, jeli, ko što su svi bili, ne, Kidrić i Đilas i Tito i tako dalje, to je bio kratki kurs SKPB. Kratki kurs SKPB je preveo Tito na srpski. Ili dijelom preveo, pa ga je neko iskorigirao i tako je preživio da ga Stalin nije smaknuo u Moskvi. Kako ću smaknuti nekoga koji prevodi mene, ne? To je jako lukavo bilo Tita, jel? Svi su vjerovali u to. Pa sad nam Stalin vele da vi idete zajedno sa kulacima, 48. 49. me optuže. Pa, to je, znate, to je oče, to je otac, otac me grdi, ja se moram dokazati. To je jedan psihološki problem. Sad ću ja biti veći stalinist od Stalina, idemo u kolektivizaciju. Bila užasna greška. Razumljiva psihološki, ali užasna. Je li trebala kolektivizacija? Pa sigurno, ali ne onda. I ne sa pendrekom. Češ tjerat nekoga batinom u raj, kakav je to raj prostor. Jel? Kapitalizam normalno radi uglavnom ne sa pendrekom, nego sa gladi. Ali ako treba, i pucajući. Ne? A ti nisi kapitalizam, ti si nekakav vlast radnog naroda, pa kako to možeš raditi? Ne? Tako, to je bilo too early, too little. Kažu Amerikanci, ne? Jer treba, pa sigurno da treba, jer jedina alternativa je ili glad, ili agribiznes. Jel? Ako nećete glad, morate imati veliku produkciju na 1000-5000 hektara. Za tu veliku produkciju trebate ogromnu mašinu, organizaciju, nota bene, rada, ne? Sve to skupa se mora naučiti. To je jedan mali seljak na svojih 7 hektara, 3 hektara, prosjek u Jugoslaviji bio je 3-4 hektara. To nikad nije naučio da treba organizacija, on ima svoju organizaciju, odličnu seljak. Danas idem kopati tu, sutra idem na posjed 500 metara dalje, odlično, preživjeli su od neolita do danas. Prosim vas seljaci, to nije sitnica. Preživjeli su Rimljane, Patarene, katoličku crkvu, feudalce, kapitaliste, sve do sada. To nije sitnica, jer sad više ne ide dalje. Sad nema jedna milijarda ljudi da se hrani, nego 8 milijardi. Ne? Sad moraš imati velik posjed. I zato moraš imati onda nekakvu političku odluku. Taj velik posjed bu ili Donald Trump, koji ti veli radi to, ili bu radni narod koji bu se svadil dok ne dođe do neke zajedničke odluke. To ja zovem politikom. Ne? Kako odlučiti o radu. Zato mislim da se meni vrlo dragi Karlek Marx zabunio kad je rekao da politike ne bu više u besklasnom društvu, ne bu politike u smislu tome da je sva politika kako ćemo bolje eksploatirati ljude. Ok, ali to nije jedina moguća definicija politike. Politika je odlučiti gdje se i kako se i po komu se i u čiju korist se koristi višak rada. Ne? Hoćemo ići na Mars ili ćemo graditi novi kanal kroz cijelu Sjevernu Ameriku. Tak nešto, recimo. To je science fiction, jel, ako hoćete. Ali u svakom mogućem društvu koje si ja mogu zamisliti, bit će nekakva politika. Hoćemo proizvoditi robote ovakve ili onakve.
Zdaj se čas izteka, ampak je pa še to, da postavimo še mogoče zadnje vprašanje pred dve.
Dve greške. Nije zakolno, znači što zakolno posao da se analiziraju, ali jedna greška odustajanje od solidarne pomoći Grčkoj, kada je prosto moralo da se odluči između Staljina, dogovora i Gandhi i pomoći Grčkoj koja održavala borbu za rat.
Misliš generalu Markovsu, jel?
Ne samo, nego prosto pomoći koja je stalno stizala u Staljinu Grčkoj i na taj način dobrim delom održavala.
Da.
I druga greška koja se meni čini ključnom, a to je raspuštanje APŽ-a.
Da. Sa prvom se slabo slažem, sa drugom se 100% slažem. Pazi, raspuštanje APŽ-a, to se tiče tebe, a mene, raspuštanje SKOJ-a. Oho, to su bile, to si si odrezao dve noge, pa si hodal na batrnicima. Jel? Zašto? To je čista oligarhija. Smetaju nam, mi smo na vlasti SKOJ, jel? SKOJ ima ogromni prestiž, pa kako može neko osim partije imati prestiž? Pa čim više centra prestiža koji rade za socijalizam ima, tim bolje. Ako jedan zahiri, bit će drugi tu, ne? Vrag. To je, razumiš, monolitizam, to je, jel, onaj stalinski... Markos, ja mislim, nažalost, to je collateral damage. Ne vidim da se to dalo izbjeći. Ako tebi stoji Staljinovi tenkovi na vratima i ti trebaš američko oružje protiv tenkova, onda ne možeš pomagati grčki ustanak protiv Amerike. To je realpolitik. To je žalosno, osim toga su oni, ko što ti bolje znaš od mene kao specijalist za Grčku, bili prilični idioti. Ne mislim Marko slično, nego njihova strategija je bila, Bog zna kakva, one pobune. Dakle, nisu bili lukavi uopće i bili bi izgubili po mom mišljenju tak i tak. You have to cut your losses, ok? Pomagali smo Grke protiv mišljenja Staljina jer smo bili za međunarodnu revoluciju. Sad moramo očuvati našu vlastitu revoluciju i ne možemo više biti tako internacionalisti. Šta se tu može? Da sam ja bio na vlasti, ja bi bio tu hvala Bogu da nisam nikad bio ni na kakvoj vlasti, ali da sam ja bio na vlasti ili barem da me neko pitao kao specijalista šta mislim, ja bi bio, zatvorite granicu. Primite ko što su primili sve koje hoće prebjeći u Jugoslaviju, pomognite im, ali vi ne možete tražiti oružje iz Amerike, a oružje koje ste dobili iz Rusije dati protivnicima Amerike u isto vreme. To ne ide, ne? To je žalostno. To je bila, mislim, iznuđena, to nije greška, to je iznuđeni užas. Jer to bio užas? Jeste bio užas. Politika je puna užasa. Mislim, politika u klasnom društvu nužno puna užasa. Je uvijek izbor dva zla. Ogromnog zla i nešto manjeg zla.
Če ima še kdo drug, vi ste že eno mogo še bil?
A lahko je sljedeče. Zelo kratek bom, ker je bilo na kraj govora o politiki. Kad bude prestala politika kao igra sa ljudima i postoče igra ljudi?
Znači, kratki odgovor kad nema više klasnog društva. Kad to bude, da li to ikad bude, ne znam. Možda dignemo u zrak celu civilizaciju, to je lako moguće, ja čak mislim jedno, dve trećine vjerovatnosti. Jel? Nuklear, winter, šta ja znam, nema više elektrike. Zamislite si da nema više elektrike sutra, pa šta se onda desi, ne? Imate filmova, 50 apokalipsi, uglavnom jako glupih, ali otprilike dobite ideju, ne? Inače, mi se sviđa vaša igra riječi.
Da li je to utopija?
Pa sigurno, ali postoje, ako smo čitali Ernesta Blocha, znamo da postoje apstraktne i konkretne utopije, ne? Apstraktna utopija je Tommaso Campanella, konkretna utopija je Lenin. Grubo govorim sad ovako, nije sve u Leninu konkretno, niti je sve u Campanelli apstraktno, ali recimo ovako grubo. Ima nekoliko lijepih knjiga, jedna je od Buckminster Fullera koji kaže utopija ili smrt. To je otprilike točno. Danas utopija ili smrt, mislim kolektivna civilizacija, vjerovatno i 90% nas.
Stupi naprej.
Da li je moguće da je ta oligarhija koja je preuzela negdje u 60-ima, isto to, ili je to povezano da se u 60-ima Jugoslavija jako okrenula Sovjetskom savezu, prije toga je bila dosta malo, malo na zapad, malo svoji i malo na zapad, posle Stalinove smrti malo se to popravilo, ali još uvijek je dosta bilo, Sovjetski savez je tamo, to je neki prava lik socijalizma, ali mi smo svoji. Posle 60. sve naoružanje, recimo psihološka politika, dosta je naslanjena na Sovjetski savez.
Malo kasnije od 60. da.
Da, 10. da.
Čujte, Jugoslavija se nalazi geopolitički između dva carstva. Ne? Ruskog i američkog. Ona Jugoslavija stara se nalazi. Kako se može održati? Kako se održao Sijan ili Tajland? Što je bio između francuskog i engleskog carstva, pa je manevrirao, ne? Francuzi su Indokini, Englezi su Burmi. Sad idemo malo s jednima, sad malo s drugima, kad nam zaprete ovi, trčimo k drugima, jeli damo im nekakve koncesije, kad nam nisu više potrebne, uzmemo im te koncesije, pa onda trčimo povima, ne? To je jedini način, to je Tito genijalno radio. Dobro, mislim da je bilo neke nostalgije, mislim Tito je bio u Rusiji 21. Doduše nije bio ni u kakvoj revoluciji, bio u bolnici u Sibiru, jel, i tako dalje, ali je imao neku nostalgiju u tome. Opravdanu što se tiče, prosim vas lepo, onog događaja čiju stogodišnicu možemo registrirati za jednu godinu. Jel? Tamo je bila nekakva oktobarska revolucija, prosim vas lepo. Te nostalgije nisu bez veze. Samo što je on dobro shvaćao da te oktobarske revolucije više nema, nego je Bačuško Stalin koji će ti skinuti glavu ako ne paziš dobro. A posle njega je Bačuška Hruščov i tak dalje. Da li je to u detaljima sad bilo više ovako i više onako, kakve su tenzije bile unutar jugoslavenske armije između srpsko-crnogorskog kadra i nesrpsko-crnogorskog, to ja ne znam te detalje. Ne poznam nikakve radove o tome. Su bili kakvi neki arhivalni radovi, sumnjam. Ne znam. Tito je volio ići u lov na Bajkal, okej, no dobro, zašto ne bi? Kad su ga pozivali tamo. To je velika zemlja, lepa zemlja. Divnim jezikom, sa divnom kulturom Rusije, ne, nije to sitnica. A Ameriko nikad ne znaš. Amerika kad te treba daće ti 6 milijarde dolara, kad te ne treba bombardirat će te sa tomahawkima, neko što je Milošević. I ti moraš tu manevrirati. Sad, konkretno ja ne znam da li je bilo tu previše upliva nešto 70. Ja mislim da je bilo previše upliva 45. do 49. 48. ne? Recimo, meni su pričali da je Dahauski proces, to je slovenska UDBA se htjela dodvoriti Sovjetskom savezu, ono 45. Ja ne znam ništa o tome, to su mi rekli tu kolege kojima vjerujem, pametni ljudi. To je bilo previše upliva, pa sigurno. Kardeljeva ideja, zadruga, 49. To je bilo previše ruskog upliva. Ono 70. Čujte, 2/3 našeg eksporta, importa ide na zapad. 1/3 ide u Rusiju, zemlje Komekona, ne Poljsku, Češku. Dobiti jugoslavenskog Fiću u istočnoj Njemačkoj bio je san. Dobiti cipele bate u Poljskoj bio je san. Ono, bivši Bata Borovo, kak se zvao, ja ne znam, jugoslavenske, ne. Tamo su naše stvari imale prođu. Pa u Italiji ti ne možeš prodavati jugoslavenske cipele, oni imaju bolje cipele u Italiji. A u Poljskoj možeš, a u Rusiji možeš prodavati kaj god hoćeš, jer nemaju niš kvalitativnog. Osim inteligencije i kulture. Jadno. Ne znam. Međutim, u realnom svijetu ti moraš voditi realnu politiku. Kakva je realna politika? Pa isto ono kao tajlandskog kralja. Malo laviraš jedni, malo laviraš drugi. I tako se održiš, da si živ još. I još vlada ta dinastija, te ne.
Stjepan, mislim da je to ne. Za danas, zahvaljujem se še enkrat u vašem imenu i mojim predavatelju. Zahvaljujem se vam da ste prišli. Mislim da IDS Jutar pripravlja še jedno predavanje ob 8 v Trubarjevi hiši literature, oziroma pogovor o knjigi dr. Rastka Mučnika. Okay.